on that applause. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Chaotic Wholesome Talk Show, or the Table Talk Show. I don't know. I'm falling into old habits. I'm in a state. I was just telling David. Nice to see you all. Thank you so much for being here, hanging out. So many awesome friends already hanging out in chat. I'm Kay, one of your co-hosts, wearing a new shirt that I really heckin' love. David, who the heck is you? And what the heck is we doing here?
Hi, I'm David. Welcome to the Chaotic Presents Wholesome Chaotic Show Talking, where every week we talk about TTRPG stuff, how to be a better player, how to be a better GM, how to be a better person. Yes, we can tell you how to do that. All with a focus on intersectionality and inclusion.
Too.
Everybody buckle up. Here we go.
We both had a day. So, yes, we got some stuff going on this month, y'all. It's Pride. Thank you to everyone who came by for my birthday stream. That was so very much fun. I still haven't fixed that counter, Ribbonanza. I'm sorry. I'm playing video games on Thursday. It might be a slightly shorter stream because I am double booked and doing something after, but it's not something that you can watch live. So don't you worry yourselves about that. David, what are you playing Friday?
I can watch live. No, I cannot watch live.
I'm not the one you have to get permission from.
Friday, I don't know, man. Probably Darkest Dungeon, possibly before, Saw says, hey, Kay, do you know why Pride is before October? I immediately in my head was like, Pride goeth before the fall. But in reading that before, slipped into, that I don't, why? Because that's Wrath Month.
You got there and you didn't hurt yourself, and then I repeated it back, and then you hurt yourself.
Abandon all hope, ye who enter here, because the.
This is why I asked Kay instead of you, David.
To answer your question, possibly Darkest Dungeon, possibly Final Fantasy. If I play Overwatch, I will get yelled at. So Darkest Dungeon or Final Fantasy. Final Fantasy 14, because 16 apparently is out. Because who releases games in the summer? Apparently, Square Enix does. You know, we have things that we're going to talk about, but can we just recognize how utterly insane the game release schedule for this year has been?
It's been a lot.
Because, well, like,
everyone was like, games are dead. No new games are coming out during the pandemic. And it was like, oh no, they're coming. Just you wait. There was a delay.
But does that answer your question? Darkest Dungeon 2 or Final Fantasy 14, the end?
Brilliant. And I'ma just come back right here, right little old here, on Saturday at 1 o'clock Eastern. I think that's 10.
Yeah, we'll be here.
Well, we'll be playing with some incredible people and flabbergasted! Woo! Hold on, right there, woo! This is going to be a Pride Month charity game benefiting the Trans Lifeline. We have three people on the cast who are nominated for Crit Awards, so you know it's going to be a great time. Please come on by.
I'm going to be playing Daisy. She's an inventor, and it's just going to be a wonderful time.
I love watching David's face whenever I do a voice.
Yeah, there's a lot of... And if you have not come by Kay's Pokemon streams, I highly encourage it because she does the Pokemon voices. it's a solid 3 hour block of Kay not speaking, just doing different Pokemon voices.
Don't lie to people.
Listen.
That's not it.
That's all I got left.
Also, we have lost.
Don't steal my joy.
We have lost your. You need to make sure your captions are behaving. Because I still see you in the thing. Okay.
You gotta toss me another link.
Yeah, doing so right now. There you go.
I don't know why I have. Listen, Radio Dumbass is turned up to 11 today. I do miss Alex Trebek. He was one of the best of us. And it goes to show you how complex a tapestry. I click clinic. Is it not working?
No, I see.
Show me the words that I am saying. How dare you?
Do you have it open in Chrome?
Yes.
Because I see you here.
But it's not doing the thing.
Okay, I'm going to try this. I'm going to kick you, and I'm going to invite you again.
Yeah. Don't threaten me with a good time.
Like, come on, technology.
Okay.
Work.
Why not?
Make sure which mic, because you're using your headset mic, not the Razer mic, so make sure
right.
It is reading from the correct source.
It is not reading from the correct source. There, you have identified the problem. What about now?
I work in technology.
Okay, is it working now?
Okay. So yes, we will be doing Flabbergasted then... in between tomorrow, God's tomorrow, the Emergency Power Podcast. Yes, I do. Don't lie to people, Sauce. Everyone's lying to my friends today. Wednesday, tomorrow, Emergency Power Podcast. We have recorded the season finale. I'm not allowed. I am a professional. I can be both. You can be both. You can go both ways.
Especially this month.
We have recorded the finale, and I can't say anything else. And then we'll be right back here Tuesday. I got lots of other stuff going on, but that's not stuff y'all get to
know about.
I can
say plenty about the season finale of Emergency Power Podcast. Things happen over the course of the episode. Kay is their flamboyant self. And also miscellaneous people speak into a microphone. Why am I like this today? Anyway.
Y'all, we wanted to tackle a serious topic today, and it's going to be real interesting because this is where David and I both are. Y'all, we're going to talk about, and it's a term that is being phased out, and that's really, really awesome in our humble opinions. But we're going to use it because it's the thing that everyone knows. When you say what it is, everyone knows what it is. Whereas if you start using the when you start using the other words, I don't think Saucefire's pal David is picking up on the CC still.
Well, I have...
Yeah, it's working.
Closed captioning here.
Yeah. So... The closed captions on the Twitter default closed captions are not going to work for David. They're only going to work for me. But he does show up in the purple box below. Should be. Looks like. We're going to talk about race in TTRPGs. Specifically, we're not talking about who is light-skinned, who is black-skinned, who is all these various things. We're talking about things like... orcs and dwarves and tieflings and all of those various things. But of course those all do... Saucefire retracts their statement, especially about David being their pal. That hurts. You hate to see
also,
it.
Also, Sauce, since you are here and listening, I do have to follow up with you and several other people, including Rex, about things that you have messaged me. It is not because I don't like you. It is because I am an asshole. So expect feedback soon.
So unfortunately, especially because of how D&D was written in the very early days and who wrote them, who wrote it, and
Gygax? Gygax?
Yeah, I would... Yes, David ejected himself from the conversation. Hey, Rex. Thank you for coming by.
Rex, I'm glad you got my message about me being a bag of phalluses regarding getting back to people about things. Continue.
I would like to say that these folks brought their unconscious biases, but I think they were... At least some of them were at least a little conscious. Especially what we've seen recently with some TSR stuff. Definitely conscious. Also,
One of our viewers, send Kay... What did they make? $661
we're gonna,
or something
we're
like
gonna,
that?
Happy Juneteenth. The racist company made $600 in profit for all of 2023 off of their racist thing. Well done. Well done. Good job, community.
Yeah, and we're gonna... When various things that we are working on goes up on the various sites in which you can buy them, we're gonna crush that number immediately. At least that is my plan.
I am, the opposite of get woke, go broke is this, and it feels good. I've been told that the opposite of that is go fash, no cash.
Hey, I like that.
I wasn't sure if you would like that, or if that would cause you more psychic damage.
No, I like that.
Okay, good. These were originally written by middle-class individuals of a certain complexion, of a certain region in the middle of America, who just wrote what they knew, and what they knew were a lot of tropes and stereotypes. And that's been a big part of D&D, especially, in fact, I don't know if you heard this, David, Paizo just ejected Drow from both Starfinder and Pathfinder, because they are too associated with D&D, and we don't want to need it.
Ooh, that I did not hear.
Yeah.
Ooh, like, that is spicy.
This is too intrinsically tied, and there's baggage, and we don't want any of it.
Wow. Wow, so, good.
Yeah, we are, as I mentioned, race has been the traditional title for this, but it is being changed more towards two potential options. Well, several potential options. The two big ones being species, which is... better.
Fine.
It's okay.
It's okay.
It's better. And ancestry.
Which I like a lot more.
Definitely better. We have yet to see Watsi make a commitment to one or the other. Paizo uses species. I really dig ancestry, and I am... Of course, I cut my teeth. I did cut my teeth on Pathfinder. And Pathfinder switched over to using species a couple years ago. But they were still using race when I learned. And then I spent most of my time in D&D. So I still often will just be like, race. And then I'm like, cats. And then when I teach people, I have to be like, ancestry. Okay, if you look at D&D Beyond, it says race. We're not calling it that. I can't wait for Watsi to update that. Because that's going to make everything so much easier. But, do you know, I got a fun question for you, David. Do you know the species
Buffin
slash
Man? No.
Ancestry? Hey, crew! Do you know the species slash ancestry that most GMs I know ban from their table? Not because of problematic origins or fantasy racism or anything like that, but for an in-game reason.
No.
Take a guess?
My first thought was orcs, but I can't think of a reason why.
Sauce got it in one. Centaurs.
Why? Because they can't figure out how the pants go on?
I can't figure out ladders. How accessible? How do they make their world accessible for centaurs? Yep, climb a rope, centaur.
I had this whole thing planned out that I was gonna like talk about, and now it's just accessibility options for centaurs.
Mm-hmm. A world of only ranch houses. I mean, that sounds pretty great. Welcome on in, D2.
I got nothing. So it's interesting that like we talk about accessibility because like what's the name of the thing where like you start the concept where you see something over and over again?
Oh.
And it's serendipitous. Anyway, yes. It's a thing.
Jetpack, and exactly. But where does the jetpack go? What part of the centaur does the jetpack go on?
The balls. No.
This is where we are today. We're trying to have serious conversations, and David and I are 12 today.
But no.
In D&D, centaurs are the same height as humans. If it is wheelchair accessible, centaurs can go in. If R2-D2 can handle stairs, why can't centaurs handle ladders? I mean, that's a very fair question.
So here's the thing. R2-D2, His Eminence R2-D2, and I have a whole rant about how R2-D2 says a whole lot of bad words over the course of Star Wars, and your boy 3PO translates them into less harsh sounding. Like, every Star Wars film would be NC-17 just off of R2-D2's dialogue alone if he were speaking English. Also, if you have not heard R2-D2 is One of Us, there is no argument. There will be no commentary about it. He's one of us. He's on the team. Y'all can't have... Anyway. R2-D2 doesn't have to worry about upper body strength. So for one, R2-D2 isn't a person.
As much person.
I mean, you know, maybe like 60%. No. But R2-D2 a droid. And so, like, he's built to be in service of. Whereas a centaur is a sentient being.
Don't shit talk my boo, says Candace. Well, come on in, Candace.
There is a little human trapped, a very flexible little human who does not have claustrophobia, trapped inside. But like, as we've seen, like R2 has like all sorts of like gadgets and stuff inside of him to help him navigate things. Like he can pop out an arm and like electrocute somebody. He can like, you know, attach to a pulley system. Like there are all sorts of things in place that R2 has for overcoming human-shaped obstacles. But, like, a really good example of, like, architecture is if you play the Dark Souls game, especially, like, the first and the third one, where there's a big focus between the... first cohabitation between and then war between humans and giants, you'll see in the architecture that they have places like stairs is a great example, where there are giant sized stairs and human sized stairs right next to each other for accessibility of both. And so like R2 is essentially a Roomba. Like, we don't build architecture for Roombas, regardless of how cool they are. We build architecture for peoples, for the sentient inhabitants of our civilization. Now, a centaur is a sentient inhabitant of our civilization. And if you guys do, so your average person who lives in the city has not touched a horse, has not been around horses. And Kay has been around a lot more horses than I have, but I've been around horses long enough to know three things. One, they are dumb as stones. Two, they are meaner than everyone gives them credit for. And three, they're big. Horses are not small. Horses are not light. Like, you slap the side of a horse and you get like a rumble. You get like thunder, because that is a slab of creature. And so you put like human torso on top with like our thin noodly arms, just busted up a rope is easier said than done. And building architecture for getting up onto higher platforms or to multi-tiered buildings is going to present all sorts of architectural challenges, because they're heavy, okay?
And even
and as a heavy person, and as a heavy person who lives in our society, I can already tell you that our architecture is not structurally sound for people of a certain size. So if you want to throw 1,000 pounds on top of that, then there's going to be a whole lot more to say about it.
Getting a horse to go downstairs is almost impossible, because it is not good for a horse. I want to show you. I had outrage when... Look at my beautiful Wild Bound the Witchlight. I love it so much. When this book came out, one of the characters in it is this lady here.
Yep.
And don't get me wrong, she's awesome. Except I had outrage, because I'm like, why are the butterfly wings? Why does she have wings on the human part? Those wings would not support the horse. And then as it turned out, they're what the workers wear. They're not really, they're strap-on wings. They're not real. And then I
they're
was
cosmetic.
No longer angry. Yes.
They're a piece of clothing. Yes. Yes.
They are an accessory. Yeah. But I was outraged at first, because I'm like, that's not where it goes on the centaur. What if centaurs are like those goats that lick salt inside? Look, horses and goats are very different. What did Sauce say, David? What did Sauce say?
I think my pony strained her voice. She's a little horse.
I do agree with what Sauce said earlier. You should stop horsing around and get to the point.
That hurts. That hurts real bad. But all I'm saying is that... So accessibility. And one of the things I read on the internet was this phenomenon of an adjustment made for a small amount of people benefits... benefits a large swath of people. So like, you know, like the little dips in the curbs for wheelchairs. I have a cold. Doc says my horse puns are very popular. I have a cult following.
He's going buck wild today.
Nay, I say thee nay. Yikes.
Accessibility dips in sidewalks.
Yeah, and so like less than 5% of society needs those for wheelchairs and other sort of aids to get up onto the curb, and yet everyone uses them. And
you can,
so
you can
I do...
watch people in New York City like swerve to hit that little dip so they don't have to step up the 3 inches.
Yep.
Closed captioning. Yeah. I think it's time for a stampede with all the main line puns. Excellent. Thank you, Rain.
Yikes. And so for one, someone who is better informed and smarter than I needs to address the accessibility problems of centaurs. especially in a pre-electricity, pre-industrial society.
Well,
and
it's also the problem because in a dungeon, no one is going to, the bad guys aren't going to make it accessible.
True.
If the answer is there's a rope.
I don't know. I really gotta think about that.
David is going to lose sleep but solve this problem.
Yeah. The problem will get solved. But like, you know, even outside the dungeons, I think that like from an architecture standpoint, even if I don't have centaurs in my game, once I come up with a reasonable solution, I will implement that into. Okay, so they're just Jedi says teleport, and like teleportation, levitation, flight, like all sorts of, all of them are real practical solutions. However, it brings about the question of how common and how inexpensive is magic in these societies, especially in the canon Forgotten Realms. Because on the one hand, you have people who are born with an innate ability, sorcerers. Rex Birdie says, if you think your dwarven excavators are going haul stone upstairs, ramps everywhere. That is true. They're also probably like limited railway systems or cartway systems. But like the fundamental architecture of like dwarven living spaces, as they are closely tied to mining, and the very limited amount that I know about mining, means that there are concessions that they have to make for like comfort in addition to survivability, because they live and mine in the same places. Because you take any like living space that is built directly into bedrock, whether in a cave or in a mountainside or in a cliffside, like stairs take more work to make than ramps, so people use ramps.
Okay, yeah, Saucefire says, fun fact, the engine that Bethesda uses can't handle ladders. No one noticed. If they can create an accessible world with seamless accessibility, so can you. I will also say,
right,
ladders and doors are two of the most difficult things to design in a gaming engine.
Like, yeah,
to make
absolutely
them work, it's very difficult. I played Minecraft,
whereas,
it's super easy.
Whereas elevators are the best place to hide loading screens.
Hey, Kiris. Why did it not pop up for you, Chris? Ooh, I'm so grumpy. I went through and fixed yours and apparently didn't fix.
Also, literally the last game I ran had a quote-unquote dungeon. But here's an excuse for you to build a campaign around a dungeon. Hmm? Christ, I had some sort of point I was trying to make 3 points ago and it's gone.
It was everyone using dips and sidewalks was the last one.
Yeah. But yeah, my point is that one, we should make accommodations for centaurs. And like, I understand that these are fictional, like none of this stuff is real. Like OSHA isn't going to come and crawl up my ass about this. Like, I get it. But one, it is an interesting and fascinating intellectual exercise. And two, we have real-world evidence that making accommodations for small populations that have other needs has a positive impact on everyone. So why not extrapolate that out to every, like Star Trek, and I know we always come back to Star Trek, but Star Trek, You know why so many things in Star Trek are shaped funny? Because they're not based off of real world things. Like in Star Wars, a lightsaber looks like a sword because it's based off a sword. A stormtrooper blaster, a stormtrooper rifle, looks like a rifle because it's based off a rifle. Most of the phasers, Mark 1, Mark 2, and Mark 4 phasers, all don't look like guns because Gene Roddenberry was like, what if we made everything ergonomic? What if we took into consideration the human body and how the human body interacts with things? And, you know, we're talking about things that have no recoil. We're talking about things that have very light weight because the energy production is very high. So, like, you let toddlers run around, you let like little kindergartners, and even if they don't have guns, they're gonna do this with their hand and be like, but if you look at it and like, hold on, let me make sure that like I'm my camera, but like this is like the natural position of hand. And so Gene Roddenberry was like, that's the natural position of hand, let's design something that fits in there. And guess what, there have been several architectural and like home design movements built around this idea of like, humans are built a certain way, we already are bending the world to the shape of humanity. Why not go that extra like 1% and make it actually comfortable for us to live in here?
Yes, Saucefire says we want people to be comfortable when they vaporize other people.
Yeah, absolutely.
Give us a few centuries of ergonomic design and we'll get there.
Also, I'd like to point out the first 12 settings on a Mark II phaser are all various, are all stun. They're various types of stun. They're not about, like phasers aren't by default vaporizers because they'd call them vaporizers. They're designed for self-defense and for miscellaneous energy applications. So like cutting, heating, like anything you could use like an energy beam for, that's what phasers are designed for. They are not just guns.
Yeah, Matt learned this in the game that he ran, SRS Polaris, where I played the creepy android, and my palm could supercharge batteries.
Right. Yeah, Kai's hand is not just for slapping.
At Star Trek Enterprise, the phasers have two settings, and one of them is kill.
Yes, that is true. However, Star Trek Enterprise is a proto Star Trek. Like it is. We're talking about the birth of the United Federation of Planets. In Star Trek Enterprise, there were four planets in the United Federation of Planets. It was Earth, Vulcan, Andoria, and I'm missing one. We're talking before the Klingon War. Like we're talking about like before the war with the Romulans. We're talking before the Dominion War. There are many designs and iterations that they go through. And guess what? By the time they get hundreds of years past Enterprise, you know, 70 years past Jim Kirk and the dude who fell in love with an alien and ended up in a wheelchair and got delivered down there, and Spock in them, like 70 years later, they got better phasers that did more things.
I do not have the energy today to match David's nerd energy, but I am always impressed. Always impressed. I just cannot rise to that occasion today.
Today, but so like, and like the reason I'm so like fervent about this is because Star Trek is unlike most sci-fi. Ursula K. Le Guin is famous for saying, well, she's famous for a lot of things, but she also said Science fiction is not about the future. Science fiction is about now. Science fiction is about the problems. Yeah, we need more Kate.
Working on that.
Or about the problems and issues that we are having today. Every time somebody references 1984, what they're actually referencing is a callback to the 30s and 40s when George Orwell was writing it. Anybody who talks about Brave New World, and I'll be the first to say, 1984 is a conceptual book, and Brave New World is a treatise on execution. Because we get a much more practical reality of from Brave New World than we do from 1984. But that's a whole different discussion.
Rex says, so when are we getting a Star Trek RPG? And can I play the Klingon security chef? Is my volume any better, or do I need to force it up further? Y'all let me know.
Unlike most science fiction that is a commentary on the world, that like Gojira famously is about the dangers of nuclear weapons. If you extrapolate it out, it's about the dangers of taking the guardrails off of human science and the impact it can have on first the environment and then humans as a direct result of that. You look at Blade Runner, and you look at Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, and it is a question at the time in the early 80s about what we as a society, one, are willing to accept from our governments and from our police forces, and how the agents of both the government and police forces can be victims too. But in addition to that, like, the backdrop of reckless, unfettered capitalism extrapolates to blank. When you talk about not the Left Hand of Darkness, is it the Left Hand of Darkness? The Ursula K. Le Guin book, where there's the non-binary species, and the person shows up as a dude to the non-binary species and falls in love, and it's like brings in questions of like, what is trans identity, what is non-binary identity. What does the flip of the coin in terms of our society look like when it is not sex focused? And like, when you strip away that, what are the positives and the downfalls of anyway? What Star Trek does that everything else or most other things don't is, one, it is not dystopian. Every piece of sci-fi media I can think of has a dystopian bent, whether it is, you know, the King of the Monsters, Monster Island, whether it is cyberpunk and post-cyberpunk.
In its history.
Right.
But in the history, not in the present.
Star Trek is ultimately utopian. Its ultimate goal is to demonstrate how we as a people, we as a heritage, as an ancestry, can, as a species, can come together and overcome the limitations that we have. And it asks the question, once we fix all the problems that our society has right now, hunger, disease, poverty, wealth inequality, environmental issues and global warming, what then? One, where do we go from there? And two, what problems will we face, and how will we use the lessons that we learned from history to become better versions of ourselves to solve those problems? And There was a second point I was going to make, but it's gone. But the point is that Star Trek is fundamentally not dystopian. There is this air of, it rejects the idea that humans are only, that humans are reductionist, that humans are only influenced by our baser desires, and more importantly and more prevalently, our baser fears. And so, the phaser is a good example of this, because very few things developed by the Federation are just weapons, are just made for killing. Like someone earlier said, Klingons have disruptors. So like the Klingons and the Romulans have disruptor weapons. And the reason that there are disruptors is because there are shields. And shields require higher morph or disrupting or piercing shields to do damage requires, requires higher, more focused energy. So you need to develop a weapon that has higher, more focused energy. But like, not only are they not designed to be just weapons, but Star Trek does a really good job of both demonstrating all the other uses of them, and how they are used much more liberally, and also shows the origins of the non-military application of them. For instance, shields. Shields are used, like everybody says, shields up. There are always shields going. The whole reason that there's a big deflector dish on the Enterprise D, the Galaxy class, and most of the other vessels is because there's this big beam emitter that literally puts out a wave so that things like asteroids and space dust and shit don't rip up ships as they go faster or as they approach the speed of light. And then when people with energy weapons show up, they both increase the output and increase the number of emitters that are active. That's what the shields up means. The phasers that are on ships were originally used for mining. They were originally used to cut down stuff so that they could either look inside or harvest the materials. That's where they came from. Which is why the Klingons and the Romulans use disruptors and the Federation uses phasers, because disruptors are specifically designed for destroying shields and disrupting those fields, whereas phasers have a multi... Okay, I'm done. I'm sorry.
I'm really sad that Bardley doesn't have sci-fi music, or I would absolutely switch over to it right now.
I don't know how we got here with me ranting about Star Trek.
Like, half the episode has been Star Trek at this point. We tried to talk about race. We ended up talking about accessibility and then ended up on Star Trek, which that tracks for this show.
But all I'm saying is not just an important intellectual exercise, but something that extrapolates to real world and our real world relations with other to strongly consider accessibility options for Centaurs.
And yes, Rex really wants us to stay on sci-fi. Centaurs to Star Trek.
Yeah, Rex says Blade Runner, the movie, also is a treatise on how we treat our workers and soldiers when they are no longer useful, which ties back into the military-industrial complex. If you sit down and there's this huge subtext in Blade Runner. And if you read the source material, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, it's even more prevalent. This idea of they built these things. They built these automatons to do the work that is too dangerous for humans to do. Except they built them too well, and they have sentience, and they have feelings, and they can feel pain, and they can suffer, and they could die in you know, mind collapses and in atmospheric decompressions. And so there's this idea of lesser safeguards where these peoples, because they are people now, who are doing this dangerous work. And then those people who are doing the dangerous work then want to go, okay, I'm done doing this. I want to go elsewhere. And they're like, no, you can't do it. And so they built a slave population. And when you think about the military industrial complex, and we also think about capitalism and Western civilization, and the idea of capitalism needs an underclass to survive. Capitalism needs an underclass to thrive. That's how Great Britain and Spain and Portugal and Belgium got to be the world powers that they are. They used the colonies as their third class, as their underclass. In India, you have the untouchables. In China right now, you have Uyghurs, and you have other people who are huddled into camps to do work. And, you know, in the United States, you have a political and cultural divide between WASPs, you know, cis white religious men, and everybody else. And there's a stratification there, just like there is in India, where like white women are kind of at the top sometimes, but also really not. And how like Cubans are better than Mexicans some of the time, except not. And how black men are better ranked higher than women in some cases, except not. And so there are all these power dynamics that is essential for, it's essential politically, economically, and culturally for capitalism to work. And so Philip K. Dick, in multiple books, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? What was the one about the cops investigating the drug empire that they made into a movie that no one liked, but it was actually pretty good? But yeah, like you read multiple Philip K. Dick books, and it's about, wow, we're really taking these human beings and sticking them in this underclass and treating them as subhuman, and then stepping on them, but told from, yeah, through a mirror, a Scanner Darkly. A Scanner Darkly is the one. But it is through the perspective of not necessarily an average, but like an everyman sort of character, an everyman in the upper social class. So like you read Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, and it's literally this guy going, oh man, I really want to have an animal. Like, having an animal is this great privilege, and they're really expensive, and not just like a dog and a cat, but like, you know, a sheep or like a cow or unicorn or whatever the others are. And it's like, well, I can't afford a real one, so I'll get a fake one. But in some ways the fake one is better because it takes less maintenance, has less area it needs to take up, is less likely to get sad because it's stuck in a little apartment all day. And everybody sort of like focuses in on like the correlation between the main character and you know, the animal that he wants to get, and the sort of like capitalistic meaning and impact it has between, like, it is such a privilege, like animal husbandry is for the elite, and the desire to climb the economic ladder to be able to afford these luxuries. But really the undercurrent of that and A Scanner Darkly is all like, you are here in the first world, you are here in the class of haves. What the hell is going on with the underclass? And the slow realization of the main character going, huh, there's a whole group of people out there, many, many more people than people in my class who are not having a great time. And that feeling of helplessness that realistically we all feel about these exploited peoples and our inability to like do anything about it. Wow, I did not did we go on it?
So asking a centaur to pull your cart is not cool then, Rex asks.
It's perfectly okay. Forcing a centaur at knife point to pull your cart is bad. Telling a centaur that he was bred for the task is wrong. Breeding a centaur or pulling your cart is bad. And when the centaur is like, bro, I don't want to do this no more. Like, there are automobiles, there are cotton gins. Like, I don't have to be out here doing this. Making him still do it, also wrong. And that's just it. Like, I saw a TikTok from just some stupid dude on. Listen, there's a lot of great content on TikTok. There's a lot of hilarious content.
Hey, JD?
Hi, JD. On TikTok, there's a lot of knuckleheads. And so one of the knuckleheads was like, well, if someone offered you $350 an hour to pick cotton, would you go pick cotton? And he was like, of course I would. And you know what? Me too. Because the problem isn't the cotton. And the problem isn't the work. If you were offered $350 an hour to flip a burger, would you go flip burgers for McDonald's? Absolutely. Unless you have a better gig that pays $700 an hour or whatever. But like, the consent and the incentive and the respect as a human being with your own autonomy is the issue. Because if you ask me, hey, David, will you go pick this cotton for $350 an hour? I could tell you no. Now, I can. There are people in my family tree who did not have the option to say no. And so, yeah, so like asking a centaur, if you play Overwatch at all, there are these cool interactions between the characters in the waiting room before the round starts. And Arisa, who is essentially a robotic centaur, and Hanzo are there like hanging out. And Arisa looks at him and is like, listen, Bowman, I know you're standing there looking at me. Don't you even think about it. And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about. You want to ride me into battle, don't you? And he's like, and she's like, no. And that is literally this point. Arisa can look Hanzo in the eye and be like, I know what you want, dude. Just like, so, like hundreds of millions of women over the course of human history for the past 100,000 years, since we left Homo habilis and Homo erectus and became Homo sapiens sapien, women have looked men in the eye and be like, listen, I know what you want. Not happening right now. And you know what? That being able to say no is what one for anybody watching, no is a complete sentence, but being able to say no is one of the most important cornerstones of autonomy. What were we talking about? I'm sorry.
Welcome in, JD. We started trying to talk about species in and ancestries in TTRPGs.
Wow,
we got on to accessibility. We then wandered headfirst into Star Trek for quite a while.
Yeah, it's always
we circled back around briefly to Blade Runner before we are now back onto Centaur accessibility. Did we say something? Oh, that's the bot.
That is the bot. Good bot.
Yeah, normal episode. There's been... David's energy is much higher than mine, and as is correct on an episode where we are discussing race, especially just after Juneteenth, the white person is keeping their damn mouth shut and letting David talk.
And like, so we were going to talk about race, and I was briefly going to go into like the terms used, and then we were going to go into like tabletop stuff. Like, oh, centaurs, cool, tieflings, Tell me that you're a part of the Alphabet family without telling me that you're a part of the Alphabet family. Oh, you play a tiefling? Which letter or letters do you represent? And Rex has been out here. He's been having fun.
Rex knows the game.
Yeah. But then somebody was like, oh no, then Kay dropped the bombshell on me of people exclude centaurs. And I'm like, why? Why would anyone exclude centaurs?
Because climb a rope, centaur.
Because centaurs can't go up ladders. And I'm like, oh, what? They can't. Yikes. We gotta do something about this. We gotta do something about the centaurs look at the ladder. They can't go up the ladder. This is a problem we have to solve. And goddamn it, we're gonna solve.
We know what David is gonna lose sleep about now. I need David to work on other things, but no, this is what David is going to lose sleep about.
Yeah. There are like three different things I gotta write tonight. And then tomorrow, Kay is going to just open up architectural plans and be like, okay, this is how we fix the problem.
Yeah, like, so here's the thing. There are... Part of the problem with centaur accessibility is it's necessary in a very few cases. Because centaurs can... It might take them a little longer, right? But they can get upstairs. But ladders and ropes are the problem. And so some kind of teleportation spell or anything like that. A centaur with spider climb would just be really funny.
No,
just
funny
is
not the word.
Just a centaur clomping along the sideways along the wall. Like, that would be...
Centaurs don't need chairs, but they do need pants. Yeah, so like, back to the question of like magic prominence in the world, because we know that there is a section of people who have to study in order to acquire the ability of magic, and if there is a correlation with, you know, like medieval Europe with the fantasy, that we know that literacy rates are low. And beyond the most like fundamentally basic literacy, education after that is a expensive luxury. So how widespread would people who can just cast levitation spells and stuff? Imagine a charge of a centaur cavalry charging the castle, boom, right up the walls with spikes. Rex, I need you to know that I'm going to build a new monster with a whole monster block, and it's going to be deeply unpleasant, and there are going to be specialized shock troops of the centaur people, and I don't know how they're going to be invented, whether they're going to be like unholy Frankensteinish constructs. Or like Gundam pilots where they're just like physically altered specifically for war.
They just have magic shoes.
Thank you for coming by, Jester. Thank you for enduring this. We appreciate it. If they have like shoes with the stickies on them, like the suction cups.
No, they're magical they shoes because it gets nailed into their hoovesies.
Yeah. And then they could just Batman climb. We're talking like 60s Batman, where it's like Batman and Robin and the rope and the cameras on the side, so it looks like they're going up. But anyway, the point is,
remind me to tell you, David, about the horrible abomination that I am being allowed to play somewhere else, but I can't talk about it yet on stream.
Pulley platforms, which are already being used for moving freight and other miscellaneous like crates and stuff.
A centaur monk, the power of that kick.
I'm not. Listen. 5e. I gotta get to the bottom of like what a centaur. Okay, so you get 2 strength, between 6 and 7 feet tall. See, this doesn't make sense to me. Why is their base walking speed only 40 feet? Isn't the base walking speed of humans 40 feet?
No, humans are 30.
Okay, that's better. Your hooves are natural melee weapons, which you could use to make unarmed strikes.
Mm-hmm. Charge is a feat, and enlarge reduce. Ooh.
Yeah. We gotta make centaur monks.
And then what you do? Ooh, you know how you make it worse. This is how you make it all so much worse. You get a centaur monk, and then you get a small folk ranger. Either
stick him on the back.
Either, you know, goblin, halfling, stick him on the back with the wolf for pack tactics. Mounted combat with pack tactics, and also your mount is doing the attacking. Like, wolf on the other side, centaur on top, centaur fighting and also being the mount for the ranger.
Now we just need a state alchemist to fuse them all together, like a daughter and a family dog.
We don't talk about these things.
We don't. Yeah, we. Yeah, it's still one of the darkest days.
Someone figured out how to make a centaur PC who could move 300 feet around.
Yeah, it's like you take some levels in monk. Who else is a fast mover?
Look what you did, David. Making people cry.
I mean,
hashtag too soon.
Yeah.
I mean, it will never not be too soon, but it will always.
Yeah, because it's been a number of years, and it still hurts real bad. It's still, yeah.
What if a... Oh, gods. Nope, that's a bad thought.
What bad thought did you have?
This is very bad, especially as we've been trying to treat this with, like, some respect and dignity. My brain is like, what if a low-intelligence paladin, like a certain half-orc that I play... casts and fails to successfully cast Fine Steed. Right, mm-hmm. As the centaur walks up.
I mean, if you want to double down on the racism, centaur walks up and then immediately casts Speak with Animals. And then spends like an entire like month in game thinking the only way to have conversations with the centaur is to cast Speak with Animals first. And then one day, spell slots are empty, no more casts, and the centaur's like, what's up? And then kaboom! It's like, have I been racist this whole time? Yes. That would be awful. That would be hilarious. I would fall out of my chair laughing if that happened.
I'm way too white to laugh at that.
Well, yeah.
So yeah, David, would you like to educate us about some of the terms used and why? Now that we're more than an hour into this, would we like to get to the first bullet point on what we were going to discuss?
Right. So, Wizards of the Coast and Dungeons and Dragons. Nay, Saucefire, nay. I say the nay. So,
Saucefire thinks that we must hang around this topic.
We gotta rein this in. So, race in D&D. Yikes, it's time to tackle this. Yay!
We're digging our spurs in. I'm trying to stop it. Thank you, Ribbonauts.
So many puns, so much pain. Race in D&D, in 5e
we're
and
send
in
our race
previous
to the
editions.
Finish line.
The different ancestries of whether it be, you know, orc, elf, dwarf, halfling, etc., have all been referred to as races. And there is a cultural push to move away from that term. And I'm going to say something controversial, which has never happened before.
David, controversial?
Right.
Pardon me while I grasp my pearls.
Right. I personally don't have a problem with the term race, and I'll tell you why. Race, one of the strict definitions of race is descendants from a common ancestor. Throughout literature, you have heard people refer to humans as a whole as the human race. And it's true. It's 100% correct. We are all descended from mitochondrial Eve, seven women that were in the area around the Old Divide Gorge 1.6 million years ago, eventually like extrapolates to all of us. It was seven women. And we all have those common ancestors. We all come from the same genetic line. So when people use race to talk about people who have different ethnic backgrounds, it is a misnomer and it is a misuse of the term. And the idea of using race to differentiate between ethnicities and cultural backgrounds and geographic backgrounds came later. And the idea of race is really only about 400 years old. And so, in its true definition, race is not the wrong term. The problem is, bad actors seized upon it and misused it. And I can't speak for the guy who originally made D&D. I'm not going to sit here and call him a racist and a misogynist or any of those things. but what he originally intended also doesn't matter. Because we have so many things that in our day-to-day life that we use that were built or invented for a specific reason that original reason has been discarded. Like cornflakes. Cornflakes were specifically designed to reduce masturbation. I don't know anybody in the past 30 years that have tried to use any Kellogg product to reduce masturbation. Not once. And
look,
you know what?
The
world
amount
is
of people
better.
That woke up to their furriness because of Tony the Tiger?
Right. Right. All the furries that discovered themselves? But we as a people, and like especially in the context of D&D, especially in the context of fantasy races, fantasy ancestries.
That would be incredible, Sauce, you're correct.
Challenge accepted. No. That's so wrong. A dwarf has a different genetic ancestry than a human. A ASMR has a different genetic ancestry than an elf. And an orc, the same thing. And a Goliath, the same thing. So, in the truest, strictest definition of the word race, it is not... it is not technically incorrect to use that term. But technically correct is not always the best correct. And the language we use matters.
Yeah.
And so if bad actors want to co-opt certain language and to taint the way we talk about things, it is our responsibility to drag them back to civility, to drag the language that we use back to what civilized people say, what people who care about others use.
And it's also the way, because of the way the language is being used, and the way that D&D is set up, which is that, you know, there are different... This is being changed and looked at and adapted, and it is done the way it is because it's an excellent shorthand to what is already a complex system of creating your first character. Once you know how to make characters in D&D, it's fast and pretty simple. But that first time, it is overwhelming. And part of trying to make that less overwhelming is orcs get +2 to strength. Cool, that seems simple and fine, right? Except it is then very easy to make the leap from orcs are strong, orcs are also dumb because they get a negative to their intelligence modifier. Therefore, all orcs are strong and dumb. And then when you start looking at things where it's like, oh, orcs have a lot in common with stereotypes about this particular real world race, that will help racists solidify their understandings of things and continue to be racist. And that is part of the reason we are trying to move away from some of these languages, because yes, it might be technically correct. It might be technically fine. We understand that not all black people are orcs, right? Like, we understand this. Because we are at least trying to be good people. But there are people who are actively trying to not be good people. And they use this to support their theories and teach their children these same things. And then when you say, I enjoy D&D, they're like, oh, well, that means you speak like me. And they start to weaponize our own inclusive and welcoming things against us because they have interpreted it in a very shitty way. And we'll use that against it. We know these people. They will weaponize everything.
Yeah. And, like, weaponized language is not a new thing. Like, there is a reason that century-old terms for people with different ancestries are not okay, or terms of service violations pretty much everywhere, because that language was weaponized. There's a reason that the religious right and the political right in this country seized upon a term used by the black community in the 20s, woke, and are now weaponizing it and using it as a cudgel and corrupting the original meaning. And that's ultimately it. Fascism, hatred, discrimination are all tools of corruption. They undermine and they erode and they tear down and they divide. There's no building there. There's no conservatism as a whole is about decay. And we have a focus on growth. Just like, you know, in Star Trek, you could be a better person. You can go beyond and God, I'm gonna talk about Star Trek again. Star Trek does a good job of going, because of certain interactions that the Federation has with other cultures, stereotypes persist. And some of those stereotypes are fair and true, like the Klingons are a very warlike race. But then we find out that that is a result of a major political shift and a falling apart of consensus among Klingon. And Klingons have scholars, and they have poets, and they have teachers, and they have all of these different types of people. And it is the warriors that instituted a fascist society, and that's what we ended up with. The same thing is true with the Ferengi. Now, I'll be the first to go in about the Ferengi, because yike.
Big yike.
But most of the Ferengi that the Federation deals with are the merchant class. They are people who are trying to go out and turn a profit. And the comparisons to the Jewish community are unfair and wrong and racist and really, really awful. And in addition to that, the Ferengi, their misogynistic approach is something that not all Ferengi share, and that over the course of the show, especially during Deep Space Nine, gets dismantled, which is why I say Star Trek is about being better. Like, you have the Klingons who claw their way back from fascism and instead have this sort of like renaissance in political thought, in creativity, and in not just going around and being a bunch of like raiding parties. Instead, having a central government that is democratically elected. You know, the Ferengi have a big one could say sexual revolution, in addition to political revolution. And they're also highlighted, whether it be Nog or Worf or any other representatives in these species and cultures, that demonstrate these people are not just an amalgamation of stereotypes. And it's important that we provide that opportunity to people who play tabletop, people who play Pathfinder and D&D, is we have to not just make it clear, but also make it easy for people to go, hey, I see this stereotype. We're not going to be this stereotype. I am going to take a different approach with this. Because ultimately, like, fantasy games and tabletop should be about building and portraying a character that you care about and that you want to portray, and not be restricted by these prejudices and stereotypes.
Very well said. So, we are nearing the point of wrapping up. Thank you, chat. You have been hilarious. You have been very insightful. You helped me break David. It's been wonderful. If you have final thoughts, please get them in now so we can read them off. But David, before, I want to circle back to kind of what has been the main discussion topic of this episode.
Oh my God, we're about to
get your opinion. Okay? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Some sort of, you know, those things that will, like a zip tie where it'll go forward but not back?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Some sort of thing like that that hooks onto a rope and has little hoof-shaped stirrups. So centaur can hook that to the rope
and pedal.
Step into it, and then like haul. They only have to haul themselves up a little bit, and then they can straighten their legs, and then haul them up. Hit the mic. Haul themselves up enough to get up the rope.
That works, but I like the idea of there being some sort of like pedal system associated with that, because you're going to have a lot more strength in the horse legs.
Entertains me so much. Prashika Knot.
Listen, this is not the show to talk about knotting.
I mean, we are discussing centaurs. It might not be the worst.
Yeah.
I don't think they
but
have
But do
it.
Centaurs knot or do
but...
they not knot?
Or do they not?
Pain. The amount of psychic damage.
Yeah.
But no, I think that there is an engineering thing that would be relatively simple. Like no more complex than, say, a water wheel or milling.
That is for chaotic naughty. You're correct. But yeah, it seems like there should be there's got to be something that we can give to our centaurs that won't break the game, right?
Yeah.
Because that's
there's
the thing,
a whole website
like,
about animated knots. I'm here for it, for reasons, D&D reasons,
K-N-O-T-S.
Only D&D reasons.
K N O T S. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
No.
Sure.
I'm tying with rope. Tying with rope.
Yeah, okay, just make it sure. I'm like, it's called Bad Dragon, and we're not advertising it.
No, especially since apparently they're shitty people. But, yeah, I was real sad when I found that out, because so much people have found so much... that We're talking about good dragons and evil dragons, but not bad dragons.
Exactly. Oh, Rex has links for you.
Yep.
But yeah.
Tire Pressic. Continue.
There's centaur accessibility, because I do know I've only played in one. I played in a one shot with a centaur. But I've known others who have either been in, especially charity games, where they reach a point and they're like, you go up the ladder, and they're like, what about so and so? And everyone just kind of goes, they do too.
Yeah, we're just not going to talk about that.
We're not slowing down the game for this physics experiment, right? We're not going to create, because even if you use the hanging rope to make like a pulley system with, that's going to cut into that horse body so much.
Not if you do several loops that are distributed over the body.
Yeah, how much rope you got? It's hanging down to reach the ground. You got to wrap it around the centaur and haul them up with it?
Well, that's why the centaur always brings extra rope with him, because then you tie a non-slippable knot as an attachment, and then you can jerry-rig a harness, put that on. JD, I'm thinking like one under the armpits, hoof pits, leg pits.
One behind the front legs.
One behind the front legs, one in front of the back legs, and then one across the midsection. Maybe two. But yeah, you could weave a rope harness. Considering the fact that I have woven rope harnesses for people, that are appropriate for suspension, you can weave a rope harness for a horse that is appropriate for suspension with an additional length of rope, and then you just tie it to the, and then you gotta. But again, the problem is the weight of the horse. They're heavy. And using like little noodle human arms for that
doesn't
sound ideal.
Because, like, again, with that little ratchet thing, if they could, like, rear up, put the front hooves there, put the back hooves in the back ones, and then lift their front hooves with it, and then push up with the back hooves, and then lift the front hooves, and push up with the back hooves.
Rex says if they're wearing armor and barding, you can have connection points. It depends on the type of armor, because something like a chain shirt is just a dress / muumuu that is made of chain link. And so, like, that's not holding on to you.
All right, I think we have beat this horse.
The whole horse?
The whole horse, I think.
What about the ass?
The most battle never ever. Yes, correct. Chat, we did a really great accessibility episode.
Inadvertently, yes.
Yeah.
We stumbled right into it.
We went a lot of places. I didn't expect to go there. I'm glad we did.
Me neither.
I can't believe my little throwaway trivia of, did you know? I know a lot of GMs who ban centaurs just completely. Everything went this way now. Just there was no hope,
things.
No help. Thank you, Rex, for fueling David's nerd rants. I got on camera and realized I had way less energy than I thought I did, and that was great because we just wound up David like a Christmas toy and just let him go. He was that little dog wind up toy that flip.
Yep.
That was David today. It was great. It was wonderful. Because your friend is tired. NJ Coffee Junkie, friend of the channel, is playing Minecraft. So we might return the children to the mines.
Yeah, the children yearn for the mines.
Yeah. All right, y'all. Again, it has been wonderful. If you are one of the people who enjoys the Emergency Power Podcast, I'm so excited. I think tomorrow is episode... What is tomorrow? Which episode is tomorrow? I don't even remember. Because we record them early-ish, and then I lose track of what one's out. 21st. What comes out on the 21st? Episode 23. Ooh. Yeah. This is a fun one coming out. No. Wednesday the 21st. This is the Friendship Bracelet Saga. This is a great one. This is a really fun episode, y'all. I enjoyed it. So if you keep up on that, episode 24 tomorrow, season 3 is 27 episodes, so we've only got 3 to go before you all get to hear how the season ends. David loves it when I make weird noises. Thursday, I'm playing Pokemon. Friday, David is playing Darkest Dungeon or Final Fantasy XIV. Then please come right back here Saturday, the 24th, I'm going to turn it on again. Flabbergasted! This is going to be an amazing game. The always incredible Candace the Magnificent is going to be GMing. All of your donations will impact this high shenanigans game and will also benefit the Trans Lifeline, which is something really important right now because the world is a really crappy place for trans folk right now. So help out some people, support a great cause, and have some fun. David, who the heck is you and what the heck has we been doing here?
Hi, I'm David. This is the Chaotic Wholesome What Are We Doing podcast. Show. Talk show. Chaotic Wholesome presents the table talk show, where every week we talk about how to be a better GM, how to be a better player, where this week we talked about a whole lot of stuff that wasn't necessarily strictly TTRPG related, yet essential. Where every week we figure out how to increase accessibility for centaurs, because this is very important. All with a focus on intersectionality and inclusivity, so that everybody can have a good time, including centaurs.
So you know how they always say, like, if you're having a day, don't be afraid to take a mental health day. Don't be afraid to call in sick from work if you're just not feeling it. This is what happens when you don't do it. You get an episode like this. So,
yeah.
You know, thanks for joining us on what should have been our mental health day. I had fun, though. Thank you, David, for all of the rants and all of the edumacation. Thank you, chat. As always, you've been incredible. Thank you for all of you who stoked the fire, ask great questions, or just broke David. That's always joys. The puns are always appreciated. We are going to start the raid and flip on over to the end screen. We hope we will see you later this week, and ideally Saturday. We really hope we get to see you Saturday, even if you are not in a position where you can donate. That is fine. We have all been there. Just showing up, even if you're lurking, that viewer count really, really helps. Jason, you're just in time for us to raid away. It is great to see you. Thank you for coming by. You all are wonderful. We will see you next time. Be kind to yourself and be excellent to others. Bye, y'all.